All right, welcome to NVIDIA. Today, once a quarter, my management team gets together for what we call e-staff face-to-face, okay? Because half of my management team is in Israel, and half of them here. And so we really don't get to see each other face-to-face except about once a quarter. I have 60 people in my direct staff, and so imagine it's more than this room, okay? About this room. Is there about 60 people here?
80
guests. Okay, all right. Okay, 80 guests. That's fantastic.
Well, we're all willing to get hired.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, you know, you say that now, and then as soon as you join one of our e-staff face-to-face, you go, I don't want to be here. So anyways, it's 2.5 days. It's very, very intense. We only talk about problems. And you know, the problems that we haven't solved. So imagine, these are all the problems that we've been trying to attack and solve over the course of since the last time we saw each other. And so these are tough things. They're tough decisions or tough problems to solve. And so today is very, very intense. It's the first day of the face-to-face. And so I'm very happy to be here to enjoy a glass of champagne with you. Our company is spread all over this whole area in Silicon Valley. When we first started our company, this is kind of the outskirts of Silicon Valley, the place where nobody wants to be. Now because of us, it's pretty hip. Okay, so yeah, this is a pretty great place. This is a Endeavor and Voyager here. So this is going to be a little bit like Starship Academy. This experiment is quite a grand experiment. It was very high risk. In fact, this building is impossible to build without a supercomputer. And the reason for that is because, as you can see, a lot of the light comes from the outside. But where light can come into the building, heat needs to leave. And so the amount of light that comes into the building has to be just right. And I love natural light so that, you know, it's not as hard on your eyes. This room also, as you can see, is one giant room. There's almost 3,000 people in this room. And so today, most people are working from home, but Tuesdays and Thursdays, almost everybody comes to work. And the reason for that is because Tuesdays and Wednesdays, happy hours. And so because there's a direct correlation between attendance and happy hour, I think should have happy hour every day. So anyways, we let all of our employees decide whether they should work from home or work here or you know, however they like to do it. And the reason for that is because, as you know, we now have this incredible technology called video conferencing and all of the type of technologies that we have to collaborate. And so why shouldn't we take advantage of that so that young people, young women, young families don't have to make that false choice between build a life or build a career. Now they could do both at the same time. Okay, and so just as email and mobile devices enabled my generation to be able to work 7 days a week from wherever they like, now with video conferencing and all these collaboration tools, young people should be able to take advantage of the technology and build a great life and still produce lots of kids and help with population decline and, you know, all that kind of stuff. Okay, so that's our philosophy behind it, and we trust our employees. We are in fact the world's smallest large company. You know, for a company of our, if you will, scale, the company is really only 38,000 people large. So we're actually very, very small. We're about 1/8 the size of Microsoft, for example. So that kind of gives you a sense of it.
Jensen, just have a fresh glass.
Hey, thank you.
This is warm.
Okay.
Thank you.
You know, just so you know, I was a busboy, so the warmth, that doesn't matter. Tomorrow morning, it'll still be good. All right. So, let's see what's going on. As all of you know, one of the most important instruments of society is the computer. It is the fabric of society. In fact, it's part of our social infrastructure now. Just as we have water, electricity, roads, education, computing is part of the infrastructure. And the extension of the computer, for example, the internet is part of a social infrastructure. And over the last 60 years, the engine of the computing infrastructure has largely gone unchanged. It was invented the year before my birth, the IBM System 360, the way CPUs are organized, an operating system, and separation between software and hardware, I/O subsystem, multitasking, all of that, the common sense of computing was established literally in one press release. It's an amazing thing. The greatest, of course, as you know, IBM was the most valuable company at its time, and invented this what we now know to be modern computing. Well, for 63 years has gone unchanged until now. Over the last 30 years, we've been working on a new way of doing computing we call accelerated computing. And now, this way of computing has reinvented how everything is done. We used to do software by human coding, hand coding, and we run it on compilers and run the results of it on CPUs. Now we don't use hand coding only, we now use machine learning. We let the machine, let the computer go figure out how to detect patterns and how to learn the essence and the, what we call feature learning, learn the, if you will, the language of the data. And so now we've learned the language of numbers and learned the language of images and video and sound and letters and any language and proteins and chemicals. We've now learned the language of almost anything you can digitize. And so now machine learning has completely reinvented computing. And the processor that is best for it is NVIDIA GPUs. And that's the reason why we're here. And so we're in the process of, as you know, transitioning the world's classical computing architecture to this new modern computing architecture. Now, the application that sits on top of this method called machine learning is something we talk about every day. It's called artificial intelligence. Now, the computer no longer requires programming by us writing instructions very precisely. The way you program a computer is tell the computer what you like. So we're now all programmers, isn't that right? We all know how to program a computer. You can program it in English, in Japanese, in Chinese, in French, in German. You can program it in any language you like. And you can tell the computer what you desire. And it would systematically understand what you mean, break it down step by step, reason about how best to solve it, maybe even go use tools, reach out to other AIs, and systematically solve the problem for you. One of my favorite applications now is this application called deep research. And you know, I was saying that, well, deep research, you tell it what you want and it goes off, not just does a search, but it goes and reads papers and websites and PDFs and might even watch a video and listen to a podcast, comes back and learns from it, reasons about what it learned, and applies that knowledge to help you solve the problem, right? And so one of my favorite things now is I'm looking for a new restaurant. I describe all the things, and I tell it, read reviews, read customer reviews, read PDFs, go read web pages, and it goes off and reads like 200 different sources, and it comes back and tells me which is the best tonkatsu restaurant. It writes me a nice review, and you know, sorts it and highlights the different characteristics of each restaurant and their benefits and their disbenefits and what people say about it. Really fantastic. And when it comes back, it's now an expert on tonkatsu. It didn't just come back with the information, it came back with intelligence. And so now you could ask it all kinds of questions about tonkatsu. Pretty amazing.
Fantastic.
Pretty fantastic. Because it learned from all these different websites, now it's an expert on tonkatsu. So anyhow, artificial intelligence, this basic ability to apply intelligence to solve problems, is going to revolutionize almost every single industry, and we're seeing that do so. And so whether it's in healthcare, financial services, self-driving cars, robotic systems, you know, pretty amazing what's happening around the world. And so we're just at the beginning of that transformation from the old way of doing computing to this new way of doing computing, I'm pretty certain that the next generation, the children that are growing up, by the time that they, of course, grow up, they won't understand a world where computers, you have to go click and, you know, search and, yeah. You'll just talk to the computers. Mm. And so that future of computers that can actually even predict what you are even going to ask, understand exactly what you mean when you do ask, and can work in the background while you go off and do something else. You know, that future world where you have autonomous AI systems working on your behalf, watching out for you, you know, taking care of things before you even realize you have a desire. Those kind of systems are going to come in the near future. Okay, so this is the headquarters of all of that that's happened.